Good morning, my friends. We want to welcome you to Velderose United Methodist Church. And wherever you are watching from today, we are glad that you have joined us. And I want to say, first of all, I hope that you had a wonderful and blessed Christmas, and also Happy New Year to all of you. It is so good to welcome in a new year, isn't it? I think we're ready to move into something new after what we have been through the past 12 months. So may God give us grace as we take our first steps into these opening days of 2021. This is also Epiphany Sunday. Epiphany is a wonderful word that means to show forth or showing forth. And in this case, it's showing forth the glory of God and Jesus Christ. And that's why we focus on the Magi coming to Bethlehem to honor and to worship the newborn Lord and Savior, who probably actually was about 2 years of age. But nonetheless, you get the point. It's a time of celebration, a time when the glory of the Lord shows forth on this Epiphany Sunday. And we also want to tell you that we're going to be celebrating communion today. And so wherever you are, if you'd like to participate in this communion, you can do it virtually, you can do it symbolically, that is, just watch it and enjoy it and take it into your soul. Or else you can go to the refrigerator and get a little bit of grape juice. Whatever you're drinking, you can get that. You can get some bread, some crackers, and whatever you want to take communion with. The point is that you're taking communion, and get it during one of the slower times in the service, and then when we come together for communion, you'll have it in hand and ready to participate. We're so glad that you are with us today. God bless you as we worship together. And now let us hear Robert Richter play, O Lord, Most Holy. Thank you. Thank you, Robert, for that beautiful prelude. And now I invite you to join with Pastor Daniel and myself in our call to worship. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you.
The glory of God shines in the darkness.
Lift up your eyes and look around. Follow the star wherever it leads.
Take the journey that leads to the child.
Let your hearts rejoice. Be overwhelmed with joy.
We worship the Christ child, the hope of the world. Amen.
Let us pray. God of mystery, in the darkness of our world, your light shines with grace and truth. Open the eyes of our hearts to the glory of your love. Speak your word of truth and joy. May the mystery revealed in Jesus draw us closer to you. May the wonder of your love fill us with wisdom and peace. As we rejoice in your presence, teach us to seek justice and righteousness. Fill our hearts to overflowing with your joy, your glory, your hope. Amen. And now we invite all of you to join with us in singing hymn number 140 in our hymnal, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Pastor Daniel, what a terrific hymn that is to open our worship service. Great is thy faithfulness. Something that can certainly help us day by day to recognize and always know that God is faithful in all of his promises to us each moment of our lives. Would you please join with Pastor Daniel and myself in the reading from the Psalms, Psalms 72, 1 through 7, and 10 through 14. Give your love of justice to the King, O God, and righteousness to the King's Son.
Help him. Judge your people in the right way. Let the poor always be treated fairly.
May the mountains yield prosperity for all, and may the hills be fruitful.
Help him to defend the poor, to rescue the children of the needy, and to crush their oppressors.
May they fear you as long as the sun shines, as long as the moon remains in the sky. Yes, forever.
May the king's rule be refreshing like spring rain on freshly cut grass, like the showers that water the earth.
May all the godly flourish during his reign. May there be abundant prosperity until the moon is no more.
The western kings of Tarshish and other distant lands will bring him tribute. The eastern kings of Sheba and Seba will bring him gifts.
All kings will bow before him, and all nations will serve him.
He will rescue the poor when they cry to him. He will help the oppressed who have no one to defend them.
He feels pity for the weak and the needy, and he will rescue them.
He will redeem them from oppression and violence, for their lives are precious to him. The reading from the Hebrew Bible is in Isaiah chapter 60. Arise, Jerusalem, let your light shine for all to see, for the glory of the Lord rises to shine on you. Darkness as black as night covers all the nations of the earth, but the glory of the Lord rises and appears over you. All nations will come to your light. Mighty kings will come to see your radiance. Look and see, for everyone is coming home. Your sons are coming from distant lands. Your little daughters will be carried home. Your eyes will shine, and your heart will thrill with joy. For merchants from around the world will come to you. They will bring you the wealth of many lands. Vast caravans of camels will converge on you. The camels of Midian and Ephah, the people of Sheba, will bring gold and frankincense and will come worshiping the Lord. For this Sunday morning, we have a special for our meditation and music. We Three Kings, played by Mary Ellen Luce.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ellen, for that very beautiful rendition of We Three Kings. I invite you now to join with us in our time of personal renewal. Hear our call to confession. May we, like the Magi, have a star to guide us on our journey quest to find the one who will truly set us free. May this time of renewal and worship bring us closer to you, that the good news of the birth of light and love will transform our lives. Amen.
Please join with me in our prayer of confession. God of starlight, shine your love into the darkness of our lives. Preoccupied with ourselves, we forget the needs of others. We participate in systems that oppress. We accept violence as a way of life. We fail to respond to the cry of others. May your love fall upon us like rain on the mown grass. May your love wash away our indifference and water the tender shoots of our care and compassion. Nourished in the sunlight of your love, may we grow into people, live in righteousness, and who work for justice for all your children. Amen.
And hear these words of assurance. In Jesus Christ, God has revealed the mystery that brings grace and forgiveness. The light of God's love transforms us so that we may act with boldness and confidence. As Christ has forgiven us, we are to forgive others. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you too are forgiven. Praise to God, who has triumphed gloriously. Amen. The reading from the epistle is Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. When I think of all this, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the benefit of you Gentiles, assuming, by the way, that you know God gave me the special responsibility of extending his grace to you Gentiles. As I briefly wrote earlier, God himself revealed his mysterious plan to me. As you read what I have written, you will understand my insight into this plan regarding Christ. God did not reveal it to previous generations, but now by his Spirit, he has revealed it to his holy apostles and prophets. And this is God's plan. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe the good news share equally in the riches inherited by God's children. Both are part of the same body, and both enjoy the promise of blessings because they belong to Christ Jesus. By God's grace and mighty power, I have been given the privilege of serving him by spreading this good news. Though I am the least deserving of all God's people, he graciously gave me the privilege of telling the Gentiles about the endless treasures available to them in Christ. I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. God's purpose in all this was to use the church to display his wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was his eternal plan, which he carried out through Christ Jesus our Lord. Because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence.
I invite you to join with me in a time of prayer. God of light, you place your star in our hearts. Help us this day and always to see the light of your star and to follow it, no matter where it leads. Light of the world, fill us with your love. God of journeys, thank you for being with us every step of life's way. We pray for those whose journey is sad, lonely, or painful right now. We pray for those whose hearts, minds, or bodies are broken. Light of the world, fill us with your life. God of all the world, you send Jesus to be the King of our hearts. Help us to welcome him and show us how to make our lives a beautiful gift for him. Light of the world, fill us with your love. God of dreams, as we gaze upon the world, we pray that your dream for creation would become our dream. Use us to make your dream come true. We especially pray for your dream to come true today among those who are hungry, those who are in prison, and those species who are endangered. Light of the world, fill us with your love. God of joy, thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for the moments when our hearts swell with gladness. Thank you for the color orange and for the way sand feels beneath our toes. Thank you for peppermint and cinnamon. Thank you for computer chips and patent leather shoes. Thank you for glitter and Legos. Thank you for iguanas and cockatoos. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Light of the world, fill us with your love. Amen. And so now, in gratitude and thanksgiving, let us join together in saying the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, the Magi paid homage to the child, offering gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. May we too bring the gifts of our lives and offer them in joy to Jesus Christ. As long ago travelers laid their gifts before the Christ child, we too bring our gifts with great joy. Let us use our gifts for justice and righteousness, that oppression and violence may cease and peace may flourish. May the light of your love shine through our living, that suffering may end and all may rejoice in your gift of life. Amen. And God bless you in every way that you give to your community, to one another, and to Veil de Rose. Let us hear now a wonderful song, Morning Has Broken, as Robert and Mary Ellen play respectively the organ and the piano.
On this Sunday, the reading from the Gospel is in Matthew chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We have seen his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called the meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah, for a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel." Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me, so that I can go and worship him too." After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. This ends the lesson, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now, join us as we sing hymn number 157, "Jesus Shall Reign." Thank you.
I was reading this past week about a family who took a three-block walk to get a good look at a live manger scene. The writer, who was speaking tongue-in-cheek, shared that Mary is, as usual, dressed in blue jeans. Jesus, who looks about 2 years of age, is wearing pajamas. And the normal translation for swaddling clothes seems to be missed somewhere in the interpretation. Joseph and the sole shepherd could be twins, and apparently this shepherd isn't good at his job because there's only one sheep. An angel playing a harp leans against the flagpole. Santa Claus is shimmying down a rope while four reindeer wait on the roof. Over to the side, three turbaned wise men stand in a line, and the Magi are bringing, according to my children, a jewelry box, a golden football, and a silver sausage. The visitors from the East look as out of place as Santa. Well, my friends, our contemporary manger scenes, at least in many cases, have come to blend the biblical narratives from Luke and Matthew, as well as themes from popular culture, and we end up with some very strange interpretations. The truth is that Matthew's version of the first Christmas is dramatically different from Luke's more pleasant account. The two stories are not easy to mesh, and each obviously drew on sources independent of one another. Here is what happens when you move from Luke's presentation to that of Matthew's. We say goodbye to the shepherds and greet the astrologers. We say goodbye to a stable and say hello to a palace. We leave poverty behind and meet the king's wealth. We say goodbye to vulnerability and face a tyrant's deceit. We say goodbye to angels' voices and embrace godly dreams. And we say goodbye to Mary's canticle, the Magnificat, and listen to Rachel weeping. Yet there is one thing that Luke and Matthew have in common. There is the continual theme of traveling. People are making journeys. Think about this with me for a moment. Mary and Joseph travel from Nazareth to Bethlehem. The shepherds travel from the countryside to the manger. The young family moves carefully from Judea to Egypt. And the longest journey of all, one that would have been a challenge for ancient MapQuest or even a camel's instinct, was the 1,000-mile trek from Persia to Palestine by the Magi. The story of the Magi is really layered in mystery. What on earth could have prompted these learned and regal figures to begin, by any measure, such a difficult journey? The Greek term magoi, M-A-G-O-I, suggests that they were priestly sages, most likely from Persia, and they were probably experts in astrology and interpretation of dreams. They were undoubtedly familiar with the prophetic prophecies of Judaism of a coming Messiah. Remember that Persian astrologers had an intimate acquaintance with Judaism from the time that the Jews were in exile in Babylon in the 5th century BCE, and that connection remained over the long centuries after the exile. The word magi is also the root from which we get our word magician. In the book Ordinary Magic, John Wellwood says this: magic is a sudden opening of the mind to the wonder of existence. It is a sense that there is much more to life than we usually recognize, that life contains many dimensions, depths, textures, and meanings extending far beyond our familiar beliefs and concepts. In this sense, magic is all about wonder and mystery and letting go of one's assumptions about familiar paradigms. And there may be some of this letting go that lies at the heart of Matthew's story of the travelers from the East. Magic, but not in the sense of parlor tricks or grand illusions or in the diabolically evil magic of Voldemort in the Harry Potter stories. We're not talking about magic in this sense. Rather, Matthew wants us to grasp a vision of the good and the beautiful and the hopeful that soars beyond the familiar. And I, in my own mind, perhaps you can too, can envision the Magi inspired by an unusually bright light in the heavens, perhaps a planetary conjunction, but then being drawn by a longing, being drawn by an urge that becomes a pursuit for something greater, something deeper. And so it is with us. Is this not the case? We have powerful longings to want to touch the mystery and the meaning of life and to be embraced by that which often just seems out of our reach. Why are we worshiping together today? Why have we joined online with one another to listen to wonderful music, to hear the Word of God read and preached? It's because we have deep longings, and sometimes we can't even quite name that longing, but we feel it, and we may even call it by many other names. The sages of old were called by a longing and were led by the light of a star, and we too have been called. You've been called, and you are to seek to know clearly what leads you on your journey. I dare suggest that there have been times when that longing has urged each of us to move forward in some way, and yet we don't answer that push or that pull because of one reason or another. And often it's a fear of the unfamiliar. We get scared of what we might not know, and so rather than do anything, we kind of get paralyzed, and we do nothing at all. We'd rather stand still and look at the heavens and wonder what the star means, but find it much safer to watch it move across the sky and past the horizon rather than to go on a journey. I can't tell you why, but these magi of old, these astrologers, these individuals were truly far-seeing. They took to the road. But I think that for every wise soul who takes that risk, there are probably far, far more that see no further than the tip of their noses. The hard truth is that most of us are too problem-oriented, too predictable, and too practical to chase stars and dreams and visions. And I do not say that in any way to be judgmental. That's because most of life captivates us at the most practical and fundamental levels. We need to survive, we need to exist, and so we stay focused day by day on what's essential to do. It is the celestial wonder, however, in the eastern sky that initially captures the attention of the astrologers. And yet, it is a text from Micah that guides them to their goal. And they would have understood this prophecy, those old magi, because they would have known the prophets of Israel. The magi want to know where the newborn king resides because they want to come and show him their adulation. They believe in this. But anything worthy of worship threatens one individual in particular, and his name is Herod. Herod is worried about losing his job. He calls together his reference librarians, and he asks them to research where the Messiah will be born. And bingo, the scribe cites Micah 5:20. Listen to this verse. "And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Herod has given the very answer of his people to the Magi. But now Herod also hopes for them to lead him to the newborn king. But the beauty of the story is that God is one step ahead of Herod's evil intentions. And Herod turns out to be no match for the honest Magi. Warned by a dream, they leave, we're told, by another route. And soon after that, the Holy Family leaves for Egypt. And meanwhile, the Magi stay in Bethlehem is marked by great joy and the worship of the young Jesus. And the wise men, we're told, present their gifts, gifts of royalty, of gold and frankincense and myrrh. The arrival of these non-Jews, and remember, they're Gentiles, non-Jews. The arrival of these non-Jews of Bethlehem is a part of the divine plan. And the fact that Matthew, perhaps in some ways, is the most Jewish of all the Gospels, we find the Gospel, in a sense, being preached very early in the book of Matthew in the story of the Magi. These Magi, as representatives of all non-Jews, belong here, we're told, in the company of the newborn king. Their presence in the story paves the way for Jesus' command at the end of Matthew's gospel to go and make disciples of all nations. And so in the end, it is not about non-Jews coming to Bethlehem, although that is actually a strong theme in the Hebrew prophets, but it's really more so about Jewish disciples going out to all nations to proclaim the newborn king. If you've read this story, probably many times actually, about the Magi, the main character in the entire story is Jesus. And although you read it, he is silent, of course. And yet, in time, his birth will shatter everything we know of the status quo. The babe will grow up and bring a revolutionary ethic of unconditional love and stubborn forgiveness and radical hospitality to those who were marginalized in his society. In uncovering that verse from Micah 2 and verse 6, the chief priests and scribes identified the king as a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. The Greek verb translated as shepherd actually depicts what shepherds do with their flocks. And what do? They tend, they protect, they guide, and they nurture. Jesus and Herod are different. Jesus will rule by his gentle guardianship, his compassionate care for his people. And that would have made Herod burn white hot with angry jealousy. Let me ask you a question today. What are your longings in life? To what does God urge you to affix your heart and your mind? Some of those things we already know. God would certainly call us to care for others in deliberate ways, to give more time to our families, to our friends, to our church, to strangers, to focus on what is permanent rather than what is just fleeting and temporary. We probably know more about God's invitations than we like to admit. But friends, the Magi, they looked up. They looked up and saw something they had never seen before. question for us is, where is our gaze? In one scene of the popular movie Robin Hood, The Prince of Thieves, Kevin Costner as Robin comes to a young man taking aim at an archery target. And Robin asks him, "Can you shoot amid distractions?" Just then the boy releases the string. And right before that happens, Robin pokes his ear with the feathers of an arrow. And what happens? The boy's shot flies high by several feet. And after the laughter of those watching dies down, Maid Marian, standing behind the boy, turns to Robin Hood and says, Can you shoot accurately amid distractions?" Robin Hood raises his bow and takes aim, and just as he releases his arrow, Maid Marian leans against him and flirtatiously blows into his face. And the arrow misses the target, it glances off the tree behind it, and scarcely misses a bystander. And here's the point. Distractions come in all types, and the result is always the same. When that happens, we miss God's mark. We are often distracted from pursuing the deep longings of our lives. Question today, are we bold enough to seek God in the common journey of life? And here's another question. Are we humble enough to be nurtured in an obscure abode in a city named Bethlehem, which in Hebrew means house of bread? Let us remember that Christianity is not a set of rules and beliefs. It's not a path of magical thinking or empty theological musings. And it's not a place to merely sit or merely to stand. Christianity really is a willingness to set aside distractions. It's a call to travel. It's a call to take a journey, to follow a direction into new country. And God invites you, me, all of us, as a church, as individuals, invites us to follow the star, his star. Amen. My friends, Pastor Daniel and myself, we welcome you to a time of Holy Communion. No matter where you're at, you can participate in this communion. You may receive it virtually, of course, which you are, but also in a profoundly and deeply sacramental and symbolic way. Also, you may gather together some bread and water, juice, crackers, cookies, whatever you would deem appropriate. It's not exactly what you have in your hand that makes communion Holy Communion. It's the attitude of your heart. So we welcome you to this time together. Come to the Lord's table, all you who love him. Come to the Lord's table, confess your sin. Come to the Lord's table and be at peace.
The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to you, Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Lord. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Holy Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. From the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is praised among all peoples. By the light of the star, God led travelers to the Christ child. When they saw the child, they were overwhelmed with joy by the light of divine love. God leads us to this holy meal, gathered together. We encounter the living Christ and taste the deepest joy. Join us. We have come asking for the child, wondering where that love might be born, seeking that joy that might satisfy our thirst, wandering through the darkness of so many mistakes.
We have come to this place where wise people and shepherds and young women met. We have come to this place called Bethlehem, to this place where our hearts rise like yeast, to this place where we meet our newborn hope, to this place where we taste our deepest joy. In Bethlehem, where we assume the worst, imagining that no good can come, but we somehow missed its name. Bethlehem, Lehem, meaning bread, Bethel, meaning house. There is something here that will satisfy our hunger, no matter how long we have wandered. Here our hearts arise. Our light has come. Join with me, please. In this bread and in this cup, we celebrate something we can't quite understand, because God has made a house at this table, because God has also made a table at your house, because God satisfies our hunger in the most unlikely places, because God comes to be with us now and always. It is with this expectation that we come to the table to taste and see that God is here.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, come into this bread and this cup. Transform these ordinary objects as you change our hearts to shape and form your world. With the joy you promise, pour your grace upon us so we overflow with your love. Help us to remember how, as newborn baby might grow into a little child that would one day turn to his hope-filled friends in an upper room.
On the night of your betrayal, Lord Jesus, you took bread, you blessed it, and you broke it, and you gave it to your disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." My friends, we invite you to take whatever you have laid out before you and to eat it at this time.
You did the same with the cup after the supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out is a new covenant in my blood. Take and drink." At this time, you may participate with one another and take and drink.
May we join together. Christ has come among us. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ abides with us. And Christ will come again.
Pour out your Spirit on us. Pour out your Spirit on us. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts. make this gifts, the body and blood of Christ, make us, through them, Christ's body, alive in the world.
Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to sing now a wonderful hymn that really gets the flavor and the tenor of what we've been talking and thinking about today. Hymn number 251, Go Tell It on the Mountain. My friends, we're so glad that you could join with us today in our worship service, and we hope that your soul has been nurtured. We hope that your spirit has been lifted, and especially that your life has been touched once again by the Holy Communion. And now we invite you to receive God's blessing. Go forth, my friends, and follow the star. And when you have found the child, tell the good news to all the world. May the blessings of God's love fill your hearts with overwhelming joy. Go in peace. Amen and amen.